Hey, Tanya.
Hey, what?
Guess what?
What?
It's still Halloween season.
Yay! I like Halloween season.
Some people love it. Some people are like, yeah, whatever. Some people are like, you know, USS ambivalent about it. But, you know, there you go. It's one of those things. I think we should probably spend another podcast talking about Halloween season.
Oh, I know. Can I tell you? It's like Halloween candy. I'd love it. So
there you go. So then how about we just go live from Rochester? It's... This is FC3's Monkey Business, your one-stop shop for everything geeky, and everything can be geeky if you love it enough. Starring Billy DeTore, starring Tanya Metris, starring Dan Carmen, and starring I, myself, Chris Frank. We got guests, and we'll talk about them in a moment. This is your favorite week. This is podcast week, and now we're on to Halloween week.
This is Halloween. This is Halloween.
I think that's the Christmas movie, isn't it?
Probably.
Okay. With us today, the legend herself, Anne Leibeck. Hello, Anne.
Hello.
And for a first time on the podcast, Susan DeTore.
Hello.
I'm so excited to have you on board with us. I have been jonesing to get you on the podcast for like years at this point, plural. And so I'm so excited that we got a chance to get you on board with us this week.
It's my cheerful giggle at some of Bill's stuff in earlier podcasts. My background giggle.
Yes. I remember one of the first times we were doing remote recording, and I forgot what he said. I forgot what the whole run up was. But all of a sudden, we hear you laughing in the background, and we just lost it. We were like, "Oh my god, that's the best thing ever!" So,
and now it is Chick Flick Week on FC3's Monkey Business. Your Halloween edition of Chick Flick Week.
You know, I'll concede that a little bit, Billy, because one of the movies we're talking about is definitely chick flick territory, but I've always liked it, so it's one of my guilty pleasures, too.
Well, good. I'm glad, because I didn't hate it, but I'm not as into it as many others are, and I know a bunch of people who love Practical Magic as one of our movies, and
I
know a lot of people that love that movie, and I didn't hate it, but I don't think I'll be watching it again.
You know, it's not one of those movies that I have
through it.
Go ahead. Yeah, it's not one of those movies that I have to watch all the time, but once every couple of years, Halloween time. It's just one of those things that it has to be done. And I while I like Sandra Bullock and I like Nicole Kidman, I watched that movie for the aunts, for Francis and Jet, for Diane Weist and Stockard Channing as that tandem in the background in the supporting role, because they're just a freaking riot. Stockard Channing, in my opinion, is a force of nature that needs to be reckoned with on a regular basis, no matter what character she plays.
She is really good. I think the first time I saw her was in Grease. And she was probably around before that, but Grease is my first exposure to her. And she is, I mean, Susan will tell you, West Wing is one of her favorite shows, one of our favorite shows.
Mine too,
and she played the First Abigail Lady. Bartlett. Yep. And she's an excellent actress, Stockard Channing.
You know what the best thing about her is, Abigail Bartlett? She spoke.
Full
sentences. Had thoughts. She did things. She looked good, but she had thoughts. It was absolutely amazing.
Oh,
you could tell it was fiction.
That's an unfortunate commentary, isn't it, Susan?
I get the giggles.
We need that strength across all of humanity outside of our fiction. I think that's really where we're lacking right now. But that's a sociological discussion for another day. Today we're going to talk about Halloween movies. And while we're doing that, before we jump into that, because I know we'll take a quick break and then we'll really dive into that conversation. But I haven't walked around the panel today. Dan, how you doing there, man?
I'm doing good, thanks. How are you?
I'm doing good for an old man, I think is the catchphrase I've been using as of lately. And Miss Tanya?
Yes.
How's things? School's going well?
Yeah, actually, school's going very well.
Good deal. So. And Billy.
Have you ever fallen asleep and then woken up the next morning feeling like you broke your thumb somehow during the middle of the night?
You know, strangely enough, I actually... it's odd that you actually asked that question. I'm familiar with that. Did that happen to you this morning?
Not necessarily this morning, but it's happened recently, and
okay,
and it's still sort of confounding me. So I'm taking a poll.
I have on several occasions too, because apparently I'm a fairly active sleeper, but I did not realize that. But I have pinned my one arm.
Not that active. That's not it.
In my lifetime, I'm not that active.
I was gonna. And that's the laugh we're talking about. Oh, I love it. I love it. This is going to be a good week. This is going to be a good week. But yes, I've pinned my arm under me, and I woke up not realizing I had done that until I tried to move said arm, and it's just dead because circulation has not been restored to it.
Nice.
So that's the thing. But then our poor Billy just got broadsided by his beloved wife. Oh, man. Oh,
this is a day I'm glad my husband is not here.
Oh, why is that, pray tell?
Because he's in the barn. Just because we made him watch Hocus Pocus, and yeah, that wasn't very good.
Wasn't his favorite movie either, was it?
No, he actually, I think he went and was like, he wanted to watch like the Incredible Hulk series on Hulu instead. And I'm like, really? That's better than this?
No. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it is. I have it on DVD. So.
It's the ultimate philosophical discussion of the war between Jekyll and Hyde in the soul of every man. Okay, it's a comic book movie. Whatever, it's fine.
Oh, boy.
Yay. All right. So that's no further anecdotes,
Chris.
No further ado.
I hadn't thought about that's really interesting. I hadn't thought about it in terms of Jekyll and Hyde and the war inside the soul of every man. But that's real. That's interesting.
When you spend 4 years talking about comic books on a weekly podcast, you start thinking of the philosophical extent of it. It's really, it starts kind of becoming a natural aspect. Also, the fact that I'm an English major with a political science minor, so therefore I am a bullshit artist.
Ah, well, yeah.
Yes. All right. Go ahead. You go first. Nope. Okay.
No, I was just saying, yes, you're a good bullshit artist.
Oh, see? Yeah, you would know. All right. So we're going to take a quick break. And when we return from break, one Halloween classic and one kind of loosely associated with Halloween. And that would be Hocus Pocus with the Divine Miss M and supporting sisters, Kathy Najami and Sarah Jessica Parker, and Practical Magic with the aforementioned Susan Bullock and Nicole Kidman. So we'll be right back.
Sandra!
What'd I say?
Susan. We've got too many Susans got going on right now.
I have Susan on the brain. This is cool. I'm just so excited to have you here, Susan. So
Sandra Bullock!
Hey, you know, it's not a complete podcast unless I make some sort of a duff. All right, take a break.
Magic, the Frotter Smack only works tonight on All Hallows Eve. When the sun comes up, we have dust.
Dust?
Toast. Toast? Pudding! Fortunately, the potion I brewed the night we were hanged would keep us alive and young forever. Unfortunately, the recipe for that potion is in my spellbook, and the little wretches have stolen it. Therefore, it stands to reason, does it not, sisters dear, that we must find the book, brew the potion, and suck the lives out of the children of Salem before sunrise? Otherwise, it's curtains. We evaporate. We cease to exist. Dost thou comprehend?
Well, you explained it beautifully, Winnie. The way you said it started out with the adventure part, and then you sort of slowly
explain what.
Out.
Come, we fly. It's protected by magic.
It's just a bunch of hocus pocus.
And we are back, ladies, gentlemen, and all points in between. I hope you guys are having a great week. I hope you're enjoying yourselves. And now on to the fun. It's Halloween season, as we've mentioned a couple of times. And it seems to me like the quintessential Halloween movie these days that people talk about the most is the aforementioned Hocus Pocus. Bette Midler, Kathy Najami, Sarah Jessica Parker, a very young Sean Murray from NCIS, who only physically plays the part. His voice is dubbed the entire movie by somebody else, if I remember correctly, seeing in the
for the cat.
For the cat. Well, no, him too. Him too. I read that in the IMDb trivia page. Yeah,
I thought it was just him in regards to Binks for the cat.
He couldn't do the colonial voice.
He couldn't do the accent. Yeah. They wanted that kind of old world Pan-American kind of an accent, and Sean Murray just couldn't pull it off. So while physically he played the part, he never once actually, you can't hear him. He said the lines, but you can't hear him. Anyway, so, but who else is in this movie that we know? Peter and Penny Marshall, or yeah. Gary and Penny Marshall. Excuse Gary me. And Penny. Gary, I get Peter from. Anyway, man, I am just full of accuracy.
Peter Marshall was the host of Hollywood Squares.
Thank you for that save, Billy, and restoring some of my dignity.
Mm-hmm. Actually, the teenage boy, the actor's name was Omri Katz, and I may have been the only fan of this show, but I actually have the DVD set. He starred in a TV show called Erie, Indiana. It was on Sunday nights. It took place in a spooky town called Erie, Indiana, where weird things happen. It was very Twilight Zone-ish.
I love that show.
And I really liked that show. And he was the star in it when he was younger than he was in Hocus Pocus.
Is it almost like a precursor to Haven and Eureka?
Yeah. Yeah. Stuff like that.
Okay.
It definitely pre-Eureka. I thought it was more like Middletown America pre-Eureka.
Okay. Now, we have a mixed bag of reactions to Hocus Pocus on our panel today. We have, on one hand, we have Anne, who adores Hocus Pocus, if I'm not mistaken.
I do.
And then you have Susan, Billy, and I, who are like...
You are wrong. Yes.
I was waiting for that. Totally was waiting for who were wrong.
Yeah. Now, just I'm going to throw my opinion out there. I mean, I get it as a 90s movie, and if you look at it in the context of a 90s movie geared towards the kids of the 90s, the fact, you know, the over-the-top level of it completely can just kind of go with the flow on that one. You know, the plot devices that they use, the twists and turns that they use are very formulaic for 90s, right? And it was cute.
I don't even know if it was formulaic for 90s. It's sort of formulaic for kids' movies.
True.
And that I could picture if the Little Rascals starred in it, the same sort of wacky hijinks had happened. Or when I was a kid, there was a movie that I loved called Escape from Witch Mountain.
Oh, I remember that one. Yeah.
And then its sequel, Return to Witch Mountain. Mm-hmm. And I loved them. I haven't seen them since I was a kid. I don't know if they hold up. Mm-hmm. But I have a feeling it may be a similar type of thing.
But we've never disliked formulaic movies. I love formulaic stuff, so it's not that.
Mm-hmm.
What it reminds me of is Nickelodeon had this whole Friday night thing, which was all that, Are You Afraid of the Dark? And there was something else that was on. And it kind of fit in with that formulaic Are You Afraid of the Dark thing, where it had
Goosebumps?
No, it was Goosebumps was not on Nickelodeon, but I just remember Friday night watching this from maybe seventh grade until 10th grade. Mm-hmm. So 91 to 94-ish. So it kind of fit in with that whole thing. And it was highly advertised during this segment on Nickelodeon. It was the Friday night Nickelodeon teen thing. And they advertised so much Hocus Pocus that everybody had to go see it.
Fair. Okay.
And it has retained an audience. And one of the last things I think that happened in Rochester before the pandemic shutdown, mm-hmm. was a showing of Hocus Pocus at the Kodak Theater with Kathy and Jimmy doing a Q&A afterwards.
Oh, really?
So,
okay, I missed that.
So I know it happens and people love it. It just didn't strike us as... And to be fair, we didn't watch the whole thing. I think I told you guys, we watched maybe half an hour of it, mm-hmm. and thought, well, this isn't for us, and we'll let you guys who've watched the whole thing sort of tell us what the pleasures of this movie is.
I got through the whole movie, but I did start kind of effectively putting it into background noise. And I know what's going to happen. There's going to be friends of mine listening to this podcast and going, oh, God, we're going to disown Chris at this point. But, I was like, okay, I want to get through just so I can see the whole story so I can talk intelligently about it. Okay, great. But there was a point where I was like, I'm done here. This is enough for me. And then there's Anne, who will tell me I'm wrong. But
but you know what? I think a lot of times things are... I'm thinking about Anne's point about everybody had to go see it. Mm-hmm. At some point, it's not necessarily about the quality of the movie or the quality of the record, or it kind of becomes divorced from quality as an objective sort of thing. Although I don't know if you can be objective about art, but it becomes more about the group environment. There's things that I absolutely love because I think of them as a snapshot of a period of time that was just fabulous and magical. I love disco because I think of gay bars and dancing to disco in gay bars, and Bill hates disco. And he's like, how, you've got such great taste in music. How can you possibly love that? And I'm like, it was the zeitgeist. It was, you know, the spirit of the times, and it brings that back.
So it's, so basically what we're seeing is the spirit of the 90s in this case, the, or is I kind of applying kind of a similar outlook?
I mean, I maybe. Anne?
I applied to almost like, during this time, there was a lot of Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen movies out.
Right, because they were the thing.
Yes, and I just go back to thinking it was Mary Kate or Ashley Olsen or Hocus Pocus. I know what I was choosing every time. And then I'm going to go back like 10 years after this movie came out, I had a niece born, and we used to watch DVDs all the time. My sister didn't have cable, and we would watch DVDs. And I just remember Hocus Pocus was the one that got burnt up the most, because that was the only one that I would watch, because I didn't want to watch, you know,
Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen
over and over and over again. But those movies went under that same formula, I think, you know, drama, help, another thing falls into place, something happens, end the story, everything's good, you know? But again, I've said this, I'm a huge Bette Midler fan, and the 90s was Bette Midler, and I think she carried the movie for a long time.
Well, but,
yeah. To be fair, though, Susan and I are huge Bette Midler fans. We've gone to see her a couple times up in Canada. Just we're fans of her music, of her comedy, and we were hopeful of this movie going in, and it, unfortunately for us, it didn't click.
Did you get to hear the song?
No, I'm sorry.
There is two. Well, I think, well, I know one song for sure in it.
Well, she does her rendition of "I Put a Spell on You" towards the end too. So, and that's, it gives you the chance for Bette Midler to sing, which I thought was great. You know.
See, I just Googled Hocus Pocus. It came out in 1993, and I think in that those years or that year. Jurassic Park, I saw Mrs. Doubtfire, I saw Groundhog Day, True Romance. So, I mean, there were movies that I guess The Fugitive. God, I love The Fugitive. But I guess that movie just, well, and you're younger than me. So that movie was more for you at that point. I'm guessing then.
93. How old was I? I was 15. So,
I just had a side thought. I'm just thinking of a pair of characters I would love to see in a spontaneous side by side. You know, they share a scene together. Would be Winifred Sanders and Mrs. Doubtfire together in one scene. I think that'd be amazing.
I would agree with that. I vote for that, but we can't do it.
I know. Unfortunately, that's not possible, but still, it'd be a cool, it'd be fun to see that one in action. Let's hear from the two that have remained silent thus far, because Anne is very pointed in her opinion so far, and Susan, Billy, and I have been kind of mentioning ours, but I have not heard really from Tanya and Dan yet. So you guys watch this, and what thoughts? Are you in the middle? Are you on one particular side of the fence?
Remember, I'm a check your brain at the door type person.
You are good at that. Yep.
When I'm watching movies and things like that. And I mean, it was fun. Is it something that I would watch every year? No, I'm not into it as much as Anne is. I've seen bits and pieces of it. And truly, when I watched it a couple Saturdays ago, it was like the first time I truly watched it from beginning to end. Because I've only... as I said, had seen bits and pieces of it prior. It was fun. It was enjoyable, but I'm also younger than Billy and Susan, but I'm older than Anne. So I'm like right in that mix. I mean, 93, mm-hmm. I was 21. So right.
Yeah. You and I were both early 20s at that point.
So I'm like, as Billy was looking at, I'm like, yeah, I saw Jurassic Park, The Fugitive, Schindler's List. I think I saw those well before I saw Hocus Pocus. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I mean, it was something, it was fun. It was enjoyable. As I said, my coworker, Anita, she loves this movie. She's on the side with Anne. Mm-hmm. So she will watch it like every Halloween time, like several times during the month. So I think her DVD would be burned out too.
Daniel's hung?
I mean, I kind of agree with Tanya about being good at checking my brain at the door there. So, I mean, I enjoyed it. I mean, it wasn't, again, it's not one of my top movies, but I enjoyed watching it. And I would watch it again sometime, not every week or day or anything, but I would watch it again.
For the two that are, you know, good at the, I'm not going to overanalyze this, I'm not going to overthink it, I'm just going to enjoy the movie. Is there something about the movie that did appeal to you? Was there something about the story, something about the characters?
It was just silly.
Just the silliness of it.
You know, I enjoy watching silly movies sometimes. I mean, it wasn't any big meaning behind it, not big, uh-huh. You know, it wasn't, mm-hmm. I mean, the actors were good. It was fun. I mean, it was silly and fun. It wasn't trying to get much out of it. I was just trying to enjoy myself for an hour and a half there, whatever it was. And I did.
And maybe I should go back and look at it, because I do like silly movies. One of my favorite Halloween movies is Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein. I've always loved the Three Stooges and goofy stuff like that. So it's not like I'm some type of brainiac, but
those are a different type of comedy, though. I mean, they're, if you love the Three Stooges or whatever, Abbott and Costello, you're gonna pretty much love most of the stuff they do, because they're. I mean. Yeah, I mean, this is just, you know, one-off thing, so it's harder to get in on this.
Yeah,
looking at when this was released, it was July 16th. Looking at the two like silly type movies that would be different for Billy, it would either be Hocus Pocus or Coneheads. I'm thinking he's going Coneheads.
I grew up with those early Saturday Night Live years, and I've always liked them. So, and I don't love the Coneheads movie either, but out of the two, I would definitely take, you know, Dan Aykroyd and Jane Curtin as the Coneheads.
And then between Hocus Pocus, Coneheads, and Robin Hood, Men in Tights, Chris and Dan would be going Robin Hood, Men in Tights.
We're men in tights.
Tights.
So just looking at
around the forest looking for fights.
at the movies that were being released around that time, I'm like, okay, I'm looking at, I'm like, I haven't seen Benefit of the Doubt, which was the same day as Hocus Pocus. I haven't seen Free Willy.
Free Willy.
So, I mean, it's family drama, and and Hocus Pocus is family horror comedy. So I don't know. It's just, but just looking at the movies that it was going up against at that point.
Right.
And I think looking at the demographics, it definitely wasn't like the demographics of the 20 something, even though it was family, mm-hmm. and us being early 20s, we didn't have like the family values yet, because our parents were older, and it's just, we didn't have any kids at that point. So I don't think that was something that was geared for us.
Is there a lot of Halloween stuff? I mean, Billy mentioned, you know, Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein. I think we did kind of glance over, and I'd like to talk a little bit more about, you know, it's the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown. But are there any really other Halloween movies?
Halloween.
That would be the political season for 25, Chris.
Yeah.
Other than the Halloween series.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Halloween, the horror movie.
Oh, wait.
Is that really the quintessential Halloween movie, though? Is the horror movie?
I think most people associate scary Halloween movies with scary. Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
So let's see. Clue.
Oh, the square pumpkin.
The witches.
Okay. Oh, The Witches of Eastwick, or is that a that's not a Halloween movie. That's just
right.
Share to be badass.
This is 1990. The Witches, a tale of a young boy who stumbles upon a gaggle of witches, is still so popular. Mm-hmm. It's even getting a remake to star Anne Hathaway and Octavia Spencer.
Ooh.
Okay, The Haunted Mansion.
I love that movie.
Okay.
Amityville Horror.
Not so much.
Ernest Scares Stupid. Sorry.
Jim Varney.
One that I've seen and I probably wouldn't want to go back and watch again is Pet Sematary.
No. Oh, wow.
I read the book. I like the book better than the movie.
Well, yeah, that's
true. I like the book better.
In most cases,
we've talked about that on several podcasts where, you know, book versus movie, the book is going to win 9 times out of 10, you know, 99 times out of 100.
Yeah. I'm not sure I agree with this one, but Edward Scissorhands is considered a Halloween movie.
It has a Christmas feel to it.
Yeah.
Edward Scissorhands.
Trick or Treat.
Somebody once tried to convince me that E.T. was a Halloween movie because Halloween was featured in the movie.
Well, there's your Die Hard argument.
Yeah, Die Hard is a Christmas movie.
It is.
Yeah.
It is. I believe that, but...
I don't know. It's like... Well, here's that Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen movie, Double Double Toil and Trouble.
Oh God, that was awful.
That was also 1993. That's why.
And Justice is Swift Leibeck. Oh, that was awful.
The one that is hysterical is Monster House.
Monster House.
That is really funny.
Monster House.
That movie.
What is Monster House? When did that come out?
2006. The scariest house on the street has a mind of its own in this spirited adventure story. Basically, it's an animated movie. Uh-huh. I have it on DVD. It's a little spooky at times. Uh-huh. But it's definitely geared towards kids who are watching the house across the street because it like swallows basketballs and then spits out tricycles and
is that the animated one?
Yes.
I remember that now. Okay, yes. I do remember watching that with Jules when she was itty bitty little.
And the three kids are trying to get everyone to see that everyone avoids this house like the plague type thing. Don't and it's truly the old man's trying to protect all the kids from his wife, who was a circus freak and died in the house, and she's now taken over.
Yeah, I remember it all now. Yeah, that one's coming back to me.
The Craft.
Ooh, there's a good one. And that's going to help. That's going to help us move in the direction where we wanted to go with the conversation. So you have The Craft, and apparently they're making a Craft sequel.
I don't know if they can ever redo that one, because that just had the right charisma and everything to it.
Neve Campbell, Fairuza Balk, Robin Tunney, and unfortunately I cannot remember the fourth young lady's name. So hopefully Tanya, the investigation expert, will be
able to help.
I'm going to vamp like a mother until I can get that name. But yeah, I do remember The Craft and watching that and being all, ooh, I mean, it was very stylized. And then that leads into your TV conversation about Charmed and,
it's, you know, shows like Craft Legacy.
Craft Legacy is going to be the sequel that they're working on right now.
Yes. The official trailer is on demand October 28th. Kaylee Spaney?
Kaylee Spaney? Okay. Unfortunately, I don't know her well enough to say, oh, yeah, she's from South.
She's playing Lily. Mm-hmm. Fairuza Balk.
Mm-hmm.
Lovie Simone. Michelle Monaghan. David Duchovny.
David Duchovny was in The Craft?
This is The Craft Legacy cast.
Really? So they got a couple of them back for the sequel. That's cool.
So, it was Gideon Adlin, Julian Gray, Zoe Luna. Now let me go back to The Craft. Fairuza, Robin Tunney.
Right.
Rachel True. Skeet Ulrich? What a name.
Skeet Ulrich is the guy from Scream who looks like Johnny Depp.
Right.
Christine Taylor.
She played Marcia Brady in the Brady Bunch movies. Okay. And she's married to Ben Stiller.
Is she really? Are they still together? I thought that Ben Stiller went through a divorce recently.
Maybe. I don't know. Then. I thought they were, but.
Christine Taylor. Let's see. They were separated in 2017.
Ah.
So they're not officially divorced.
If those two crazy kids can't make it in this world, who can?
Breckenmeyer?
Breckenmeyer.
Oh, yeah. No, I know that kid. Yeah. I've seen him in quite a bit of things.
Oh, he was in Child's Play?
Mm-hmm. Oh,
another Halloween movie.
And Rat Race, one of my favorite silly movies.
Garfield the movie. There you go. Clueless. And this is how we get off on a tangent.
Yep. This is usual. This is par for the course. Our listeners are not surprised that we're here right now. But we can take The Craft, which has a more, and I'll say it, practical look at things, right? It is still an over the top teenage drama kind of a story, but it's not mired in the cute childlike silliness of Hocus Pocus. It's starting to move towards a more, you know, giving you that feel this could actually be like a real setting. Mm-hmm. And then we'll bounce off The Craft real quick. We'll come back to that another day. Maybe we'll do a podcast about The Craft.
I haven't seen it.
And things like that. And
I haven't seen The Craft.
And we'll dive into Practical Magic, which I know is the movie that a few of us really wanted. So we're gonna do this tennis match where there was a movie that some of us wanted to talk about, and some of us were like, eh. And now we're gonna go to a movie where some of us wanted to talk about, and some of us are eh. You know, it's kind of a balanced aspect of things. Yeah, but Practical Magic, which came out in 91 or 95? No, 95, I want to say. I think
98.
98. It was after Hocus Pocus. And as I had mentioned before, Nicole Kidman, not Susan Bullock, but Sandra Bullock. And a young Evan Rachel Wood played one of Sandra Bullock's daughters.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, the little redhead.
Uh huh.
So, I thought it was a great way, the way they introduced the movie, the way they came up with the run up. They talked about the Owens legacy and with the way they kind of introduced the story and how they brought it into play. Now, Susan, I know you love this movie, and I think you're actually a bigger fan of it than I am, and I enjoy the hell out of this movie. But what is it about this movie that brings you to it?
I think part of it is kind of the woman's empowerment thing.
Okay.
I have never met a movie about someone who is struggling and downtrodden and then triumphs over evil. Mm-hmm. I didn't I love that stuff.
Oh, yeah.
So I think that was a big part of it for me. Uh-huh. You know, all of the women are kind of outsiders.
Mm-hmm.
Outsiders and outcasts because they're different. And because they're, and then they triumph over that.
Mm-hmm.
That's not gender specific, but I like the women doing it.
Okay. I think you also see different points of the spectrum. There are the aunts who are my favorite characters in the entire movie who have embraced it. They are it. They have no problem with it.
But they're also older.
Yes.
So it really shows like the generations of, I don't know, kind of female experience, mm-hmm. you know, when you're young and hopeful, when you're young and then kind of midlife, it's sort of like, oh, I'm sure I can still fit in. And, you know, then when you get to me my age and it's like, yeah, fuck it. Like, I don't care.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, but then you have the dichotomy between Sally and Jillian, where Sally is just like, no, she wants nothing to do with it. She wants, she wants to fit in. She wants to conform. She mm-hmm. wants to, you know, she wants to be left alone and not ridiculed for what she's gone through. And she's not seeing the story that she's a part of. But I think it's an intentional kind of a cutting herself up from it. But then there's Jillian, who is the other end of the spectrum, where she's dove in head first, but then I don't, but would you call it she's abused it, or or it's just the way she's not really learned how to control it. I'm not sure how to talk about how Nicole Kidman's Wild Child kind of fits into that story I'm trying to knit here.
I think of her as just kind of, you know, the casual destruction of someone who's kind of self-obsessed and self-obsessed with youth and wildness and being mm-hmm. the bad boy or bad girl and sex. Okay. I don't think it really had anything to do with the magic per se. I think she just, you know, was hormonal and there wasn't enough going on the island.
Yeah.
Right? Like she had to leave.
Uh-huh. I see her as a person.
You can't say it better.
I see her as a person who knew who she was and knew she wasn't going to be happy where she was, so she left.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I see her. I agree. I see her as a really powerful character. Okay. She got in over her head. But I see mm-hmm. her as like, yeah, go for it.
Mm-hmm.
I see the aunt as raising these girls to be strong and empowered in who they want to be.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one of them taking it and using that to, you know, leave the island and do what she wants. And the other one to be like, I want to raise my family.
Mm-hmm.
So every woman needs two empowering, strong aunts in their lives like these two aunts.
I was looking at, I don't know, maybe I was overthinking it, and maybe because being male, I have a disadvantage at really understanding the relationship sometimes. But I looked at the two sisters in the middle, you know, Sally and Jillian, as they were working apart. They were pulling apart from each other because they each wanted that particular goal for themselves. But apart, they were not as strong as they were together.
Right.
That the one needed the other. And it didn't matter which one you were looking at first, but Sally needed Jillian to remind herself of who she really was as 100% person. And Jillian needed Sally to rein her in a little bit so that she, you know, to so that she could be, you know, see the whole thing without getting herself into so much trouble. And I maybe a limited way of looking at it, but I saw that as the two sides of the coin, you know, and like, I don't know. I had a really kind of cool thought, but then I forgot it because, you know, I'm a dumbass. But
that's also kind of the thing of gender specific movies, mm-hmm. like the male buddy cop movie mm-hmm. or the male war movie. It's the same thing. It's the yin and yang, whether right. it's male or female sisters. That's a trope.
And that's a, you know, that it almost feels like the word trope has become
a trope,
a dirty word. Mm-hmm. You know, it feels like it instead of just saying, okay, well, that's a trope that's identifiable. That's a kind of a par for the course kind of a thing. It's like, oh yeah, that's a trope. It's like, oh, that just flattened that whole story out, didn't it?
Oh okay, my God, really?
In talking to a lot of people, it's really, that's the feeling I'm getting is when I hear trope, it is said with a tone that's like, oh, it's just that's a typical trope. It's like almost like
that there's a negative connotation.
Thank
to
you.
It.
Yes, Billy. And,
oh, I didn't mean it like that at
no,
all.
And I get that. I'm just saying this seems to be something that is becoming more and more prevalent, at least that I've noticed. You know, because
lots
I try
of words
to
words have been co-opted.
Well, yes. That's a podcast in and of itself, that concept, that conversation right there. And I agree. And co-opted, and see, and we've even used the tone co-opted. It has almost a negative connotation to it. Like that's, it's, these words are being abused.
So co-opted has been co-opted.
Co-opted has been co-opted.
And is now a trope.
It is now a trope.
Oh boy.
Off the rails.
Off the rails.
This is nothing.
Let's try it. We're going to circle very abrasively back towards Practical Magic at this point. And let me ask this question. Who played Jimmy? Oh, God, I can't think of his name right now. Gordon Vicinic, who I remember seeing on ER. I've seen him in several things. Right now, he was in Timeless. Right now, he's playing a part in season two of The Boys.
Is he?
Yes, he's playing a background character who's got his own, you're starting to learn that he's got his own machinations now.
Oh, Alistair Adana.
Yes. And he's this amazing actor. I want to see more of this guy on screen because he's got this magnetic quality to him. That's like,
I tell you, he's very good looking.
Well, there's that too. He's a handsome fella. But I also like his character on ER was a very interesting. Lupa. Yeah. Had a very interesting kind of arc to it. And yes, I watched ER for a while, but after a while I just got tired. I couldn't keep up with it. It was a great story, but I just couldn't keep up with the, you know, they would reach into your chest and pull your heart out and bounce it around the room for a little bit before smacking it back in your face. And I'm like, I can't do this anymore. Anyway, tangent. But he was our villain in Practical Magic. He was our adversary. And I think it was an interesting villain role because it really wasn't that persistent character with an arc throughout the story. Like you're used to, like with the Marvel movies, you have a villain who has a goal and he's trying to work towards that goal. Jimmy was just kind of this presence that focused the rest of the story around it. It, that's the impression I'm getting, at least in this one. So
wait a minute. What do you mean he was the presence that focused the story?
Well, here's where I'm trying to.
The bad guy.
He was the bad guy, right? But without, he really didn't have a goal. I mean, it's like he just was just being this menacing presence in the background. He wasn't trying to. I don't know. He wasn't trying to like defeat something or have a victory over something. He just wanted to be this present. He just wanted what he wanted. And I thought that's what
he was obsessed. He was obsessed with Jillian and he wanted to keep her no matter what type thing. And he's,
I'm saying, I'm not trying to like lessen it. I'm not trying to like talk it down. I'm just saying it's an interesting departure from the usual villain story. It's like, you know, he's not trying to blow up the city or he's not trying to conquer this. He's not trying to, he's just holding on for dear life to this thing that he wants more than anything. So
he's trying to blow her up.
Well, there's that.
You know, if you want to look at it like that, like from a diehard perspective, she's the building. He's holding the building hostage. I mean, any woman who has ever been in a relationship, or a man, but it's more typically women, who has been in a controlling, violent, scary relationship, and then told, if you leave, X will happen, and then has been stalked afterwards. You know, yeah.
Here's my question then. I'm overthinking it then. I'm trying to apply a very, I'll just say it, male kind of outlook on this. I'm looking for the good, the bad, you know, the hero journey, the villain journey. I'm trying to put it together as almost like an action movie. I'm trying to put this together in my head to try to justify why I like certain parts of this movie. Am I making sense now at the moment?
Well, are you trying to say that you liked parts of him and you want to figure out why?
No, I think what I'm doing right now is I'm having a revelation at this point where I'm like, I've liked this movie for so long and I'm wondering, because you had mentioned how it's just this great story about female empowerment. And I agree with that sentiment. Exactly. I think that's a fantastic way of looking at it. I'm now trying to figure out why I've liked it for so much. It's more than just cute girls running around. Right. And so I'm looking at it from my perspective going, wow, why have I liked this movie? And why am I trying to push my view on it?
Chris, you love female empowerment.
What's that?
No, even if you couldn't see it, you love female empowerment.
I do. I really do.
Yeah. I mean, you're all about that, even though it didn't drop into your lap like, oh, this is female empowerment movie.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of who you are. That makes a great deal of sense to me.
Okay. Cool. Okay. Yeah, it's weird because sometimes these podcasts are a discussion where we're exchanging ideas, and then sometimes it's therapy for me while I'm rolling heads, you know, thoughts around in my head, and I'm trying to understand why I'm looking at things the way I do.
I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
If you're turning to Billy for therapy, I'm so sorry.
It happens more often than you think.
Oh, no, it's so great. No,
sorry.
It's great.
I would pray for you now.
No, that's okay. There's a lot of love in this panel. There's a lot of love in the panel because it's there are times where it's Tanya's turn. There are times where it's Dan's turn. There's more often than not, it's my turn. You know, and then Billy will talk about stuff that's important to him. And I think that's why we've had so much fun with this podcast for as long as we have, is that we just start talking about whatever's on our heads. And then that's where I was like, wait a minute, why do I like this movie so much? And am I looking at it from the wrong angle? No. Okay. I'm good. All right, here we go.
Ann and I like the movie for Midnight Margaritas.
That is a fantastic scene. That is like one of my, it's not one of my favorite scenes, but it's definitely up there. And I love it because the whole cast comes to life in that scene where Sally was such a stick in the mud for most of it. But then all of a sudden, you know, Jilly wakes her up and it's Midnight Margaritas. And suddenly Sandra Bullock's Sally becomes this entirely different character dancing around and having a grand old time.
I have a question about that.
Yes.
Do you put rum and coconut in a margarita? Is that like a thing?
You can, but no, margaritas are typically tequila and lime.
Yeah, that's what I thought. You put the rum in, but that was the rum in the coconut song.
Right, that's the rum in the coconut song.
I guess there's no cool dancing tequila song. Oh, I did a shot and then I threw up. Ooh, it was so great. Ooh.
Yeah, well, there's no tequila song.
Well, no, there's dent, tequila.
Pee Wee Herman tequila song. Come on. Tequila. Because everybody's going to think of Pee Wee Herman at that one, and I don't know if that makes it cool anymore.
Now, was it during Midnight Margaritas as they were slinging insults at everybody?
Yes.
Okay, and so looking at the trivia.
Yep, I was going to say that.
According to Sandra Bullock in the commentary, in the scene where Jillian and Sally get drunk with their aunts and they sling insults, the actresses really actually got drunk. They were drinking some very bad tequila that Nicole Kidman brought.
Really?
So that was purely them drunk.
And just throwing elbows at each other for their own entertainment.
Yes.
I'm going to say this, that next con weekend, we need to have Midnight Margaritas in Tanya and Ann's hotel room.
Okay. I'm in.
And for those that don't drink, we can make virgin margaritas.
No, there'll be margaritas.
I don't drink tequila. Tequila's horrible.
It's because you haven't had the right tequila.
Oh,
yeah. If you have good tequila, then it's
an entirely different creature.
It's an animal all to itself. It's, I'm like Wheeze. I've discovered tequila, and it's a bad relationship. It's a fun relationship, but it's an
interesting animal. Not necessarily. No, I just like some of the quotes that came through. I was looking at the quotes.
Fire off some quotes for me.
The one that I really liked is when the aunts were taking the girls away. So the and Sally goes, and I don't want them dancing naked under the full moon when they're going to the festival. And Aunt Jet goes, "No, of course. The nudity is entirely optional, as you well remember." And then when she's casting the spell, when she's very young, you'll hear my call a mile away. It's all that fantasy that when you're like little, that you're wishing for, like your Prince Charming or your princess, if you're going to the opposite way. He will whistle my favorite song. He can ride a pony backwards. And Jillian's like, "What are you doing?" And it's just like, that's the point. The guy I dreamed of doesn't exist. And if he doesn't exist, I'll never die of a broken heart. So she knew then that she didn't want to necessarily fall under that curse of the Owens woman's curse. So
only to do so nonetheless.
Yeah.
Can I point out what I think is the biggest flaw of this movie?
Tell me.
I think it's the title. And that the title to me connotates like this light, fluffy, romantic comedy, like a Bewitched type of thing. And it's not. I went in expecting something funnier than it was. There's a couple funny moments, but it's a heavy, no, not super heavy drama, but it's more thoughtful than it is wacky.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and I think the title makes it feel like it should be lighter.
Okay. Okay.
Well, if you look at the title and then you look at the picture of the advertisement of what's like the movie poster, mm-hmm. it's very dramatic. It's not. I'm like, both Sandra Bullock's and Nicole Kidman's faces are like got that we're not messing around type thing. We're pretty serious about who we are and right. things like that. That they don't, whereas if you compare it back to Hocus Pocus, which is hot. Sorry. I'm derailed. It's more colorful and lighthearted, whereas the Practical Magic movie poster is basically candles and it's black. It's very dark. So it's not necessarily, the title might lead you astray to have it be more lighthearted, but looking at
now 20 years after the movie came out or however long ago it was, I'm not looking at the advertising or the poster. I'm just going, okay, I've got to watch Practical Magic. So I pull it up on, the magical internets to watch without seeing advertising or, okay, I've got to watch Practical Magic so I can talk to my friends this week.
No, even Googling it, the very like the images for it, it's just the very first one is the movie poster. But I don't know. That's just me.
Can I say another thing that I just absolutely love about this movie?
Absolutely.
I can't remember what the rating is, but it's some, I think, God, someplace in Europe. It's
PG-13.
No. Oh. It's a different kind of a rating. It's a rating for how women are portrayed in a movie.
Oh, okay.
Are they an accessory? Are they used to enhance the male, them? Or are they a real whole person? Or are they, in effect, boobs or legs or, an accessory?
Mm-hmm.
Is it the Bechdel?
Bechdel
movie list.
That's it. Yes. Yeah. So the thing that's so fabulous about this movie is the women are the whole characters and mm-hmm. the men are kind of monosyllabic, with the exception of the cop that shows up.
Aidan Quinn.
Yes. But other than that, the men are the gender roles are kind of reversed, and I really like that.
That it is a good touch. It definitely helps kind of enhance the whole, this is geared for a particular type of story. It's geared to a particular type of audience too.
Well, no, actually, surprisingly, mm-hmm. stories that are geared towards women have similarly low Bechdel scores. The women are still the artificial, I'm sorry, this is like way too.
Nothing is too
way deep. Way too in-depth for people. A fun podcast.
That's
but,
okay.
I want to say it was like 80% or 90% of all movies, women are accessories.
Mm-hmm.
And this was one of the few, and really for the 90s, women were very much accessories. And this was one of the few that really changed that.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't a lasting change, God knows. But they changed that.
I like that. That's good. Change is always good. Well, not always good, but it's always welcome when it comes. Well, maybe not always. I'm going to stop talking. It's funny. I think of these positive influences and then I'm like, yeah. And then I'm going to make this broad general statement. And then as soon as I make the broad general statement, something pops into my head of, no, that really wasn't a good idea after all. Never mind. It's like, oh no.
I think this movie helped a lot. I mean, I remember in the 90s, if you were Wiccan,
mm-hmm.
it was a negative connotation with it.
Right.
And this movie, to me, helped other people who were Wiccan understand that you can be good and happy and live a very healthy life and still be Wiccan.
Yes.
And it brought out a lot of the powerful, good Wiccan people in our communities.
I have
several friends who are Wiccan. Mm-hmm. And yes, they do dance naked under the full moon. And yes, they do bless you when you're pregnant. And it made me as a person be not as afraid to go to their house and have dinner because I knew they were Wiccan and I accepted them way back then. But then seeing the movie with them, with me going, oh yeah, that's pretty much what we do. We laugh, we have fun. You know, we might not be able to actually light candles, but we praise the nature. It's not about, you know, just being evil. And it's about just and loving life. Right. And that to me brought a huge light to a lot of things. So one of our FC3 people is Wiccan. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how I started meeting her was one of our other friends introduced me to her. And she owned a Wiccan shop off of Monroe Ave at the time. And
I remember that shop.
Yep. The Magic Box.
Yeah. It was awesome.
Yeah. Yep. Then so I used to go to that shop and buy candles and stones and rocks. And it mainstreamed the fact that Wiccan is not bad, that it's good in the 90s.
Yeah. Which was sorely needed. Yes. You know, and I've met several those who profess Wiccan over the years. I met them as early as when I was in high school. And you know, when you're raised in Catholic schools and you go to a Catholic high school and now suddenly you're hearing all this other stuff, it's like, wait, what? Mm-hmm. I was told you're weird. Why are you weird? And you know, no, you're not acceptable. And that's such a terrible way to look at the world. And so it was great to be able to meet these people and interact with them. And then, you know, I'm recovering Catholic. So I'm moving on into the greater things of what the rest of the world has to offer. And yeah, you can see how this movie brings it to the forefront, puts a spotlight on it and says, this is all right. This is really what kind of it's all about. It's not, you know, what you're told it's been and moves the conversation forward.
Yeah. To me, I was able to go to the library and pick out books on it and read and learn more about it. And and I think for a lot of people, it was about, okay, we're going to learn to read or learn more and not just judge somebody based on what's going on. I mean, because look at how at the end of the movie, how they used to say, oh, they're going to fly on Halloween or everybody's going to bring their brooms. And at the end, all of the women in the community joined together with their brooms to help rid them of this problem.
Yes.
So they took from being afraid of them to accepting and loving them.
Yep.
Yes.
Because I think they were waiting for Sally to actually acknowledge out loud that she was a witch.
Well, yeah, the one girl with the punk rock hair that worked for her was like, Sally came out.
Came out.
I'm like, oh my God. Just,
great way to talk. And even Aunt Jet goes, there's a little witch in all of us.
Uh-huh.
And it's true. And it's like, they have to pull out the coven in order to take care of that. They need a full coven. And they're like 9 women, but 12's better. And then Aunt Frances is like, do you have any friends? And he's like, she's like, oh yeah, the phone tree type thing. And as soon as she did that, they're like, ooh, now we get to, I think because they didn't know exactly what they could do or what they couldn't do that. They're like, ooh, now let's see. And they kind of brought them in and let them partake and understand. Because when you don't understand something, you're very quick to disregard it or say it's bad or evil or whatever because you don't understand it.
Right.
In
that climactic scene, first of all, I want to talk about the neighbor who brought the dustbuster. But but more to the point, you know, it was interesting to me, you know, and the person who likes to overanalyze things because I think I'm intelligent. In that final climactic scene when they're in their circle and they got the brooms all around and whatnot, and they're all doing the chanting, it was interesting to see the varying degrees of how you got into it. Like the ants were, they're physically at peace. They were into it. They had their rhythm. They knew what they were doing. There's that confidence there. there were some of them, you know, some of the neighbors were, you know, kind of like very trepidatious. They were very kind of like, you know, we're in it, we're chanting, we're doing the right, I hope we're doing the right thing. And then there was the ones that were like, they were at a full on, they were headbanging at a metal concert. They were going full tilt boogie. And it was just interesting to see how everybody kind of, and nobody was wrong. And it was great to, because I think what sold it for me was, I mean, I always refer back to Stalker Channing because I've had a crush on her since the first moment I saw her. You know, where at one point she kind of like she peeks around, she's looking, and she just seems content. This is, everything's going the way it's supposed to. She closes her eyes, back to work. And so that kind of sold the whole thing that no approach to this was wrong. And I thought that was just the coolest thing. So there's an observation.
It's a very good observation. I agree.
Thank you.
It was accepting of everybody, no matter how their stance was and how they were helping, because they were all helping.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. Final thoughts on this movie.
Watch it every year, over and over again, and you'll love it even more.
There you go.
I agree.
Susan agrees.
Yeah.
I'd watch it again. I didn't dislike it. Mm-hmm. I think I need to watch it with a different expectation going in. And now I know what to expect, so I can look at it differently.
Right. Right, right.
Because I do like Sandra Bullock and Nicole Kidman and Stockard Channing and you know, the rest of the cast. It was very good.
Tanya?
Oh, I'm definitely watching it again.
All right. So we're going to take another quick break, and when we return, we will have our question of the week.
I am newt, toe of frog, will of bat, tongue of dog.
Adder's fork and blindworm sting.
Barbados lime is just the thing.
Fragger's song like a sailor's stubble.
Flip the switch and let the cauldron bubble.
How convivial!
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm hoping everybody's having as much fun with this conversation as I am. I am totally Jones. I'm Susan, you have to come back more often. I love having you on board for the conversations. It's great. It brings a whole different level to it. And I'm thoroughly loving having you here with us today. So I appreciate your time.
Well, thank you. I've enjoyed this.
And great. That's the best part. That is always the best part. When the people who join the conversation have just as much fun with it as I do, then that's the win right there. Now, Susan, this is the part of the podcast where we do our question of the week, where we have like a little kind of an off-the-cuff conversation. And Dan has this monstrous list of questions. I think there's like 320 some of them. We lost Dan again.
381.
Oh, wow. There was like 315 last time, wasn't there? You've added?
I've been added for a little while.
Okay. Nice.
But yeah.
So, Susan, we would love it if you picked a number between 1 and 381.
Well, okay, I've got a problem here. Because I was going to pick 420. And obviously I can't because the numbers don't go up that. But we were talking about smudge sticks, so I thought, hey, okay. So I'll go with 240.
240. All right. We ready?
Yep. Go ahead.
If you were given unlimited resources, how would you lure the worst of humanity into one stadium at the same time?
Oh, I know, I know, I know, I know, I know, me.
Oh, well.
Susan, go ahead.
I would say you'll be able to see a favorite person you want to see, and we'll give you a t-shirt and a hat.
Your brain and mine went to the same spot at the same time, but you were more enthusiastic about wanting to see it first. You know, we glance over politics in this podcast very much like an asteroid skips over the Earth's atmosphere on its way by. You know, you'll see a meet.
That might not have been political. That might have been for a band that I don't like.
Let me finish. Real quick. Kanye, hang on a second.
I didn't say anything.
I know for once.
No, I said Kanye, not Tanya.
Kanye.
All right, hang on just a second. Because, you know, we glance over, but we don't really dive in and make quote-unquote statements. However, anybody who's paid attention to our podcast over the past 4.5, almost 5 years now at this point, will know exactly how we think and who we are talking about when we say things like that. So I want to tell you, I'm completely on board. The only question I would have is there a stadium big enough?
Well, you have unlimited resources. You can make a very, very, very large stadium.
We can build a stadium.
So it would be, instead of Burning Man, it would be Orange Man? We'll do that out in the desert. Tanya, how about you? How would you do this? What would be your bait?
Can you read the question again? I got lost.
If you were given unlimited resources, how would you lure the worst of humanity into one stadium at the same time?
I'd make free guns. I'd make sure that there was no virus because it doesn't exist. Because I'm the youngest and healthiest person ever.
Yeah.
And perfect physical specimen.
I'm almost regretting this question now. I don't know.
You know what? We probably... Okay, this is what happens when you go for... Just say no to drugs. All right? So I think we should probably do a do-over question. 25.
Okay.
Well, I was going to say, everyone's thinking the worst of the worst for like the political sense, but I'm like, what about the worst of the worst of like bad criminals, like the that type of thing? And it's like I didn't necessarily go political, not like everyone else in the room possibly went type thing, only because I'm on the opposite side of the spectrum. But I'm not a supporter of that person, but I am on the opposite end of your political spectrum to it.
And you know, that's the thing, is that there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. But we have forgotten.
I married a Republican.
Not me. One of her 19 other husbands.
Just 19? Wow.
She's beating me on this one.
Actually, two were Republicans. Two previous husbands.
But, you know, even getting into that little political arena of the two-party system or whatever, Republicans and Democrats aren't what they were 20, 30, 40 years ago.
Oh, easily.
Well, they were 5 years ago. Come on.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, just because, I might be, like, that registered Republican doesn't necessarily mean that I vote or look at everything on that same aspect. Everyone's like, oh, you're a teacher, you must be a liberal, or you must be this, and I'm like, no, type thing, because just people go to that stereotype or that looks at that demographic.
Generalizing what they are.
Right.
That's where we've gone as a culture at this point. Here we go completely into a different zone, and that's fine. It's good. These are good conversations.
And actually, Tanya, you're right. Why didn't we automatically go to criminals and murderers and rapists?
Because we have the highest pick of the day here.
Oh, man, I didn't go in any of those directions. My answer was totally way off base then.
Tell me, what was your answer, Ann?
John Deere tractors.
Oh my God.
So what's the worst of humanity? People that like John Deere tractors?
Yes.
I love John Deere
tractors. And we can't be friends anymore. My dad grew up with John Deere tractors and things like that, and that's how I learned how to mow the lawn on a John Deere tractor. Come on.
But my lawnmower is a John Deere, but everything else on the farm is Case International.
What's the farm?
The farm is Case.
Yeah, well, if the farm hadn't been Case and it was John Deere, would you be putting Case International up there or Kubota?
No, I'd still put John Deere.
I would just lure them with cookies.
Oh, I could lure them with cookies.
Because everyone is a sucker for a cookie.
Oreos or chocolate chip.
It doesn't matter. As long as they're not oatmeal raisin.
Seriously, oatmeal raisin is the biggest scam of all time. It's a chocolate chip cookie. And then you bite into it. It's like, wait, what?
You've just made an enemy.
I had so many disappointments with oatmeal raisins growing up.
Chris, now those are fighting words.
But Susan, everyone else can love them. I don't.
No, wait. Susan,
I put a vex on you. I put a bad mark on your record.
But this is the good thing.
That might help.
The good thing, though. Check this out. If there are oatmeal raisin cookies, you know that I'm going to willingly, happily share them with you because I know that you enjoy them and they will not go to waste. Again. See, there you go.
Yeah, that's
But you're right. The very worst thing ever might be expecting a chocolate chip cookie and biting into an oatmeal raisin.
Now, here's the thing. My ex-wife did this once, and it earned her several bonus points. She made oatmeal raisin cookies, but she threw chocolate chips in them, and I did not know that. Right? So she's like, here, try this. I tried this new recipe. I'm like, what is it? She goes, an oatmeal raisin. I'm like, all right, well, I don't hate them. It's just they're usually the scam, in my opinion. And then so I get the cookie and I eat it, and it was great. And then all of a sudden you get that little burst of chocolate, and I'm like, ooh, this is a whole new cookie. This is amazing.
You stayed married to her for an extra year because of it.
I actually was two, but yeah.
There'll be triple chocolate brownies in our house this afternoon.
I'm looking forward to that, as is my A1C. I'm telling you. I'm the only person at the D&D table who is not in the Metformin Club, and I think you guys are working hard to make
Hunter's
me part
not.
Of the team. Oh, yeah. So Hunter and I, you know.
Tyler's not at the table consistently.
Well, there's that. I wasn't counting him, so. Yeah. But anyway.
Can I make you some chocolate chip cookies?
Yes. Yes, please.
Cookies saved us from a political discussion. That's amazing. That's like a headline there somewhere along the line. All right, friends, that's enough. That's a wrap. We've covered enough ground and enough. We've used enough tape.
Hey, Chris.
Digital space. Yes. Hey, Tanya.
Do you remember the outtakes now?
Do I remember outtakes?
The out cue.
Oh yeah, I do remember the out cue. You don't need to do that to me at this. See, now you're making me think about it. If I screw the out cue up, it's your fault, because now I'm thinking about it, because it's like it's reflex action. I'm like, so I wrote it and I just perfected it. And now it's going to be like, hey, Dan.
Hey, Chris.
Hey, Dan.
Hey, Chris.
Hit it. Because this has been MMC's Monkey Business, a product of the Mighty Monkey Corporation, purveyors and producers of the Flower City Comic Con, coming at you April of 2021. Like us on Facebook, like us on Twitter, like us on Instagram, follow us wherever we go, and we will lead you to where the entertainment is. All y'all have a great week, have a safe week, and we will talk to you again next week.
Dun, dun, dun.